God is for me. Who can be Good morning and welcome to the Trinity Temple Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'm Larry Williams. I'm the associate pastor here. And I wanted to say thank you for joining us for worship this morning. I know we've been missing for the past couple of weeks, but we're back and we're making adjustments here at the church. We've already moved our noon service back into the building. And in a couple of weeks, we're going to move our morning service back into the building also. But just for today and for next week, we're still going to be doing our pre-recording for our first service or for our 9 a.m. service. So we just wanted to give you a heads up about what's going on. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, I thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to be here with you in worship. Lord, I pray that you will continue to be with my friends that are viewing us on YouTube or whatever other channel that they may be finding us on. I pray, oh God, that you would bless us today, open our hearts and our minds so that we might get the message that you want us to walk away with. Bless us today, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Today I want to share just a couple of thoughts with you around the subject, because you are worth it. Because you are worth it. The power of self-care. You know, when we think about this idea of self-care, you know, we find ourselves asking the question, what in the world is self-care? What are you talking about today when you're talking about self-care? Self-care is what we, believers like you and myself, it's what we deliberately do to take care of all of the aspects of our life. You know, some of the benefits someone has said around self-care is that self-care can improve our physical health. Self-care can boost our emotional health. Man, self-care can help us maintain a sense of focus when it seems like our lives are getting out of focus. Someone has said that self-care can bring a sense of calm and peace into stressful seasons of our life. We become more productive when we take time out to practice what we call self-care, because it gives us back this sense of peace and focus in the midst of storms that we may be experiencing. Really, what does self-care mean to the believer like yourself and myself? You see, self-care means that we learn to recognize that we have that we have a relationship with ourselves and that we need to make ourselves a priority. You see, sometimes practicing what we call self-care means that we're calling ourselves out around things that we're doing that really aren't helpful to us or healthy for us. That's what we mean when we talk about self-care. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. This is what Paul says. He says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. But stay with me. He goes on. He says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. Watch this. By the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God and what is good, what's acceptable, and what's perfect. Hey, did you get that? Paul says, listen, we need to transform our mind. We need to periodically regroup our thoughts so that we can understand what God's will is for our lives. Sometimes we become so overwhelmed and we become so bombarded by all of the things that are out there. We need to take a step back and just relax and get refocused so we can understand and hear God's voice clearer. Jesus admonishes us to take care of ourselves. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. This is Jesus speaking. He says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. You know the rest of it. He says he'll give us rest. You see, when we're overwhelmed or we're stressed out, he says, come and I'll give you rest. When you just can't go one step further, he says, make your way to me and I'll give you rest. He says, stop doing what you're doing. Come to me, take a break, catch your breath, and get refocused. That's what he's simply sharing with us. You know, most individuals who don't practice this self-care, I've discovered in my own life, when I'm not practicing self-care, it's usually because of three philosophies that I have in life. Number one, I don't practice self-care because I believe the lie that says I don't have enough time to really take care of myself. I need large blocks of time to practice self-care, and that's a lie from the pit of hell. We can practice self-care with just small bits of time every single day. Another reason why I don't practice self-care, or reason number two, is because I believe that I don't have enough money to practice self-care. In other words, I believe that it takes a lot of money for us to be able to do what we call this self-care thing and to take care of ourselves and take time out sometimes to simply just be there for me. And again, just like the first one, it's a lie from the pit of hell. We can practice self-care without any money. It doesn't cost us anything. You know what the real reason is for most individuals, including myself, of why we don't practice self-care? And it's probably the same thing with you if you're really honest. We don't practice self-care, or I don't practice self-care, because I really don't believe that I'm worth it. And it's probably the same with you. Man, we look at other individuals and we realize that they need to take care of themselves. And sometimes we share that with people that are important to us or people that we love. We share that you got to stop and take care of you, but we never internalize that. We never really believe that I deserve to be taken care of. Sometimes we don't believe that we're important enough to be cared for. We believe it about everybody else, but not necessarily about ourselves. You see, people don't practice self-care because they think they don't have enough time or they don't have enough money, when it really boils down to the fact that we don't believe that we are important enough to be taken care of, or we're not worthy enough that we should be taken care of. Some individuals believe that self-care, or to practice self-care, is an indulgence. Self-care is a biblical principle, watch this, that is really God-honoring. You see, self-care helps individuals like you who are under a lot of stress and individuals like me that have full schedules. Self-care helps us to become the healthiest, the strongest, the brightest, and the best version of ourselves that we can be. And that is what God expects. Let me say that again. That is what God expects from believers today. That we are the best version of ourselves that we can possibly be. You know, this became apparent to me a while back. You know, before COVID, I used to do a lot of flying to different places. And then I would hear what I call airplane ministry. Oh, get this. This is really pretty cool. You know, during the pre-flight information, if you've ever taken a flight, you get in and you sit down in your seat and you get your seatbelt buckled and you figure out where your snacks are and where they're going to be and where you place them. And then it's during that pre-flight information that the flight attendants usually come out and they say that, you know what, just in case we have emergencies during the flight, or if we have an emergency where the cabin loses cabin pressure, then oxygen masks are going to drop down from the ceiling. And then I'm always amazed because they admonish us if we lose cabin pressure and an oxygen mask drops down from the ceiling of the plane, they admonish us to practice self-care. Hey, what do they say? You know it. Repeat it with me. They say, put your mask on first and then assist others with their mask. That's simply practicing what we call self-care. Ah, new idea, right? You see, we see this idea of practicing self-care. We see it threaded throughout the entire scriptures. It's like the great teacher God is telling us that we need to set boundaries in our life. And as a believer, there will be times when we become physically tired. There are times when we become emotionally frayed and we can be emotionally burned out. There are times when spiritually and physically we're hungry and we just can't take one more step. It's during those times that God invites us to do what we can to rest and to take care of our own needs. I know there's this lie that's floating around out there by believers that we've just got to keep on working and God will give us the strength even when we're tired. And bless your hearts, there are times when God comes in and he gives us the strength to press through stressful situations. But God has never, ever asked us as believers to just work ourselves to death without any regards of taking care of ourselves. Have you ever wondered why at the end of creation, after God creates everything on that seventh day, he pauses and he takes a rest? It's because God was modeling for people like you and for people like me, because we don't have sense enough to adjust and take downtime on our own. And so God is modeling for us how we should behave in our lives, that there needs to be time where we step away from all of our work and we pause just long enough to take care of ourselves. Oh, there's a fantastic story that illustrates this idea of self-care over in the book of 1 Kings chapter 19. In the book of 1 Kings chapter 19, it's the story about Elijah. And you know, you've heard it. Elijah had just experienced a grueling season of ministry. Man, there are times when God just steps in your life when you're doing ministry. He just steps in and things are just out of the ordinary. God just shows up and shows out. That is the only way I can explain it. And that's what had just happened in Elijah's life. He had faced the 450 prophets of Baal, and in this powerful monarchy, God shows up to share with them that he is the true and powerful God, the only God. And God responds in such a mighty way that he shows that he is who he says he is. And all the accolades are there. Man, it's a stressful time for Elijah. And he is so overwhelmed with God's presence. And his emotions are burned out. Physically, he's burned out. Hey, let me tell you something. Whenever you have one of those mountaintop experiences with God, you know what I'm talking about. It's those times where you pray and you ask God for something about this big, and God shows up and gives you some blessing that you can't even contain or even hold. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. It's those times. It's those times where God just shows up and shows out. You need to be aware that you need to have some downtime after that, because our emotions are so out of control. That's where Elijah is. He's there. God has showed up and God has showed out, and Elijah is just overwhelmed. How do we know? Because 1 Kings 19, 1 and 2 remind us. Let me read it to you. It says, "Now Ahab told Jezebel everything that Elijah had done and how he had killed all of the prophets with the sword. And Jezebel sends a message to Elijah to say, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow, I don't make you as you have done the prophets of Baal. Hey, did you get that? It's like Jezebel sends this message to Elijah. Now remember, Elijah is the one that prayed, man, and fire fell down from heaven. She sends this message to Elijah, says, I heard what you did to my prophets, to my 450 prophets, and you need to know that by this time tomorrow, I am going to have taken your life. That's kind of rough. But what's even rougher is verse number 3. Verse number 3 says, and Elijah was afraid, and he ran for his life. Hey, when we're emotionally burned out, when we're not practicing self-care, man, we don't think as clearly as we would think as if we were 100%. Verse number 3 says, Elijah was afraid and he ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servants there while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. And he came to a broom bush. Watch this. He sat under it and he prayed that he might die. He says, Lord, I've just had enough. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. And he laid down under the bush and fell asleep. Did you get that? He's run. Elijah is just spent. He's got nothing left. Hey, have you ever had those moments in life? Well, man, you've just been doing so much and you're juggling so many balls and you're multitasking and finally you come to a point where you just got nothing left. You've used all your auxiliary power. You've used your regular power and you're just spent. You don't have anything left. He has nothing mentally. He has nothing physically. He has nothing spiritually. He has nothing emotionally left. He's just spent it all. He's given everything that he had. You see, when we're not practicing self-care on a daily basis and being healthy and strong and the best version of ourselves, when we are weary and when we are tired because we've been in the battle for such a long time, we don't think as clear as we would have if we were operating at 100%. And I don't know about you, but I do know about me. Man, when I'm weary and I'm tired because I've pushed and I pushed and I pushed, and even when I'm tired, I keep on pushing, I don't think as clear as I used to. I don't make the best decisions. And bless your heart, if I'm really honest with you guys, when I'm not practicing self-care, it is easy for me, even in my prayer life, to ask God for crazy stuff. Oh, don't look at me like that. Like I'm the only one that ever asked God for crazy stuff. You know you've prayed and asked God for crazy things before. But the thing that's really bad is that when we're not practicing self-care, we make horrible decisions. You see, being the healthiest and the strongest and the best version of ourselves is what God desires for us, so that when we do make decisions, they are sharp and they are crisp and they are clear and they are godly decisions. There are times There are times in life when we just miss it. We push ourselves to the breaking point. Have you ever noticed with small children that when it's time to go to bed, even though they are extremely tired, they will fight going to sleep at all costs? They can barely keep their eyes open. They're yawning, and you'll say, are you tired? And they'll say, no, I'm not sleepy. And then all they need to do is take a nap. Think about it. In the middle of the day, they're cranky, they're crying, and they go down and they take a short nap and they get up, and it's like it's a totally different child. Oh, somebody knows that. Man, as adults, we're the same way. God reminds us that we need to. It's a biblical principle for us to practice self-care. As a matter of fact, it's what we call good stewardship. It's taking care of what God has given to us, which is us. Sometimes, man, we don't have the sense. Yeah, that's what I said. Sometimes we don't have the sense to take care of us. But it's not just us. It was biblical characters also. Hey, have you ever read the 23rd Psalms? Of course you have. Think of the first couple of verses. What does it say? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Hey, what's the next verse? The next verse. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Hey, have you ever noticed that God has to make us lay down? We don't have sense to do it on our own. Was visiting a lady in the hospital a couple of weeks ago. And the very first thing she said when I came in and sat down and said, how you doing? She says, you know what? I'm finally getting some rest. I've been pushing myself, and I didn't have enough sense to simply slow down and take care of me. And God has this way of forcing me to take care of myself now. Hey, how many of us are like that lady? Man, we don't have sense to practice self-care, and then all of a sudden we get run down and we get burned out, and God says, oh, you'll slow down now. Why do we have to wait till we get to that point? And so in our text, 1 Kings chapter 19, God models for us. He models for Elijah, and then he models for people like you and people like me how to do this self-care thing and the importance of this self-care. Elijah's on the run. He falls asleep there. Starting at the end of verse number 5 and going into verse number 6. Look at what the scripture says. We're in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse number 5. It says, and all at once an angel touched him and says, get up and eat. Think about it. Elijah's laying there. He's sleeping, and the angel comes and wakes and shakes him up and says, hey, get up and eat. Verse number 6 says, and he looked around and there by his head was bread baking on hot coals and a jar of water. He gets up, he eats, he drinks the water, and verse number 6 says he lays back down again. Hey man, there are times in our life where we are just spent, we're just wasted. But look at verse number 7. God's not done yet. And the angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and says, get up and eat, for the journey is too long for you. So he got up, he ate, and he drank. Hey, did you get it there? Man, Elijah is laying there, and he's come to this place, and he's asleep. And God hires his own private chef to come in and cook for Elijah, because Elijah is just spent. He can't do anything else. All he can do is get up and eat and lay back down again. He's just overwhelmed. Doesn't happen once. It happens twice. He is so wasted, he is so spent that he can just barely lift his head up enough to just eat and lay back down. Notice how God doesn't expect for him to cook his own food. He doesn't have anything left. So God does the self-care for him because he doesn't have the strength to do it on his own anymore. You see, Elijah's season of extraordinary service had left him neglecting just the basic things that he needed in life, which was basically rest, water, and to be able to eat. So what God does is that he kindly brings these things to Elijah and places them where he can care for himself. He's modeling for Elijah and modeling for you and modeling for me how important it is for us to take care of ourselves. Hey, if you're in the caring profession like I am, it is so easy for us. So easy for us to think about pouring into other people and taking care of other people and not including our names on that list of taking care of ourselves. Man, some of you who are watching this, you're mothers and you may be single parent moms and you're pouring into your children. You're there 24/7. You do meals, you do laundry, you do all the other things that children need to have, and yet you never take time for you. God moves. And he illustrates for Elijah what needs to happen. What does he need to do now? What's the will of God for him? And you see God showing him. The will of God for Elijah at this point in his life is very simple. To sleep and eat and sleep some more. It's interesting. God lets him sleep. He feeds him. And he gives him water to drink. Hey, have you noticed that he gave him water to drink and not a Red Bull? So he could have wings and do more work? Man, sometimes we're burning our lives up. Just simply trying to do that one more thing when we know we should stop and just let it go. The Bible tells us in verse number 9 that strengthened by that food, he travels 40 days and 40 nights. Man, all he needed was just a little time out to practice some self-care, just a small amount of time, and he's ready to get back in the game again. You see, sometimes God can't use us as effectively as he wants to use us because we're burned up. And all it takes is just a small amount of time for self-care, and we're back into the place where God can use us mightily again. It's amazing that God doesn't show up before verse number 9 and say, okay, Elijah, this is your new assignment. Hey, what would happen if leadership required all of us, and it doesn't matter where you work, what would happen if leadership, every time there was this huge project that you had to work on and you got that project completed, what would happen if leadership said, okay, you need to take some time to just kind of take care of you before we start the next project? And I'm not talking about just in corporate America, I'm talking about in spiritual arenas also. Hey, when did we buy into the lie that said we've got to work 24/7, 365 days a year? I read an article some years ago, and I wish I would have clipped it and kept it. And it talks about how Americans are one of the few countries, or America's one of the few countries, where people don't take all of their vacation time. You know, your organization gives you 2 weeks or 4 weeks vacation, whatever it is, and we take a week and then we do what we call, we're banking the other weeks for other years. It's frowned upon for us to take time and do self-care. And that's why I'm spending time on this today, because coming out of this COVID-19 piece, we've been stressed out, and yet we're still choosing not to take care of ourselves. It's only after Elijah has been recharged that God challenges him with a new spiritual assignment. You know, are we trying to do God's work without God's power and God's blessing on our life because we're so burned out and we're so overwhelmed that we can't give God our very best? Elijah's able to get up and move on again and be in full service for God. God may not send angels to provide cakes for us and to provide water for us, but God is showing us today that we've got to take some time to start taking care of us so we are able to offer to God 100% of who we are instead of just 10 or 15%. Well, I'm talking to somebody today. Our story about Elijah teaches us about the heart of God and for our humanity. He wants us to be the best that we can be. I'm going to tell you, taking time to take care of yourself is not a luxury. It is a necessity. God has this new assignment for Elijah. And the new assignment is he is going to extend a call to Elisha, and he is going to teach Elisha, this new young man, the exact same things that God has been showing us. And one of those things is how to renew and to replenish himself in order to be effectively used by God. Hey, how many times, because my time's almost up this morning. Hey, how many times have we been trying to accomplish things for God, but unable to give God 100% of who we are because we don't have 100% available? You know, periodically, I give you some homework to do in this service, and this is your homework. Here's what I want you to think about. Take the next week and just kind of jot down on a sheet of paper, hey, what are you doing to practice self-care in your life, in your physical life, in your emotional life, in your spiritual life, and in your mental life? Hey, what are you doing to practice self-care physically for you? What are you doing to practice self-care to kind of deal with your emotional you? What are you doing to practice self-care to deal with your mental you, to keep your mental self 100%? Hey, you can write this down. What are you doing to practice self-care for your spirituality? You're joining and you're worshiping with us today. So there's one bullet point that you can put down. But what are you doing every day in those four areas to practice this sense of self-care? Hey, if we make self-care our gold and we try to address each part of ourselves on a regular basis, then we begin to feel better and we function better. And hey, The better we feel and the better we function, the more we can do and be what God needs to have us be and take care of the people who are important to God. And I'm going to tell you, that's a win-win for everybody. Our Father and our God, our time is far spent here today. But Lord, we recognize that many of us have been believing the lie that we've just got to work nonstop even for you. We don't have time to take any time off to take care of ourselves. And yet you admonish us that if we are to practice good stewardship, we've got to take care of these bodies, our mental, our physical, our spiritual, and our emotional selves. We have to practice good stewardship and take care of all of who we are so we always have 100% of who we are to give back to you. Lord, I pray that you would bless each person under the sound of my voice. Lord, somebody's listening and viewing this sermon, and Lord, they know somebody that needs to hear this. Lord, I'm praying that you would impress them to pass it on to someone else so that other people can become healthy just like we're choosing to be healthy today. Lord, bless us to this end. Help us to stop when rest and rest when we're tired. Lord, help us to recognize that we are worth being taken care of and then choose to do it. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Remember, we always share, do as much good as you can for as many people as you can, as often as you can. Include yourself as one of those people that you're going to do good to. Hey, God bless you. We'll see you back here again next week. Have a fantastic week.